Well, good morning to you all, and welcome to our service here on December 13th at First Parish Church in Weston. I am Jeff Barz-Snell, the minister, and we are glad that you could take some time to join us on this day, on this dreary day, at least when we are taping it here in New England. If you are a new viewer, we welcome you. We welcome you to our online worship program, and if you are a longtime member and friend, we are delighted you could take the time to tune in. We continue to miss the blessing of being gathered here in person to worship, to greet one another, and to come away renewed. Our service participants for this day include Jeff Weeding, our organist, Bill Sano, our music director, TJ Rufo Curran, our song leader, and our audiovisual producers for this day, who are Max Hall and Mr. Jacob Barz-Snell. We invite you to rise up wherever you find yourself and join with us in singing or humming along a few verses of Angels We Have Heard on High. The lyrics can be found in the order of service that was emailed out as part of our newsletter on Friday, and also are posted on the order of service in a PDF format on our online page on the website. Please join with me in singing a few verses of Angels We Have Heard on High. Thank you, TJ. I would now like to call forward Bill Sano, our music director, Jeff Weeding, our organist, to light our chalice and our Advent wreath on this All Music Sunday.
We light again the first two candles in our Advent wreath to remind us of God's gift of hope and peace. Today, we will light the third candle, the candle of joy. As we wait for Christmas, we look forward to the joyful celebrations we will share with those we love. The prophet Zephaniah calls on us to shout for joy because God will transform the people. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the angel told the shepherds not to be afraid. The angels brought the good news of a great joy, which shall be to all people. The good news of Jesus' birth and the promise of shalom are still tidings of great joy for us today. As we listen to the music sung by our virtual choir this morning, may we experience a bit of brightness and joy during this dark season. The third candle reminds us of our joy that the world can be a better place and we can be a better people.
Thank you, Bill and Jeff. We now invite you to join us in a new tradition here at First Parish Church, the virtual exchange of peace. We have this amazing technology in our pockets and on our desks, in our purses perhaps, and we accomplish all sorts of impressive feats with it on a daily basis, but we rarely use these devices to simply reach out and wish someone well. So take a moment and reach out to a few folks you know, either from First Parish or from your larger network or community, via text, email, or quick call. Send them a text, give them a call, shoot them a short email, and simply say, good morning. I hope you are well during this difficult and challenging time. Say you can't talk very long right now just because you are attending church, and it's okay if they don't quite understand that. Tell them you are participating in a service right now and wanted to take a moment and wish them some peace and health and goodwill during this time when so many are struggling. So if there's any younger ones listening, are you there? Are you watching? Call them over to the screen for a minute. Hello? Are you there? Knock, knock, knock. Can you hear me? Hi, everybody. I wanted just to answer a quick question that occasionally is posed to me on this Sunday in the church calendar. This is the third Sunday in Advent, when we light a distinctly colored candle, the pink candle. It's called Gaudete Sunday in the traditional church liturgy, in the Latin. Gaudete meaning joy. This is a joyous day in this season of Advent, and hence the color of pink. And I know that's sort of strange, because people wear, like, I have a pink tie on, I have my pink stole that I have to dust off. I wear it only once a year, a day like today. And actually, this part is turned over. There we go. How's that? That looks a little bit better, as much as it can. But it's a day in which we celebrate the many ways that we can bring joy, sometimes big joy, sometimes small joy, to people in our lives and to other people in our world. And it doesn't have to be a huge, dramatic sort of joy. Sometimes it can be a small joy in our daily lives. The joy we can foster when we are open to it. Now, I have a small example of what I mean by this. I'd like to share it with you now. This may very well be the first time in our church's 3 centuries of history that the ministers, including a TikTok video in a service. Here's my example of joy.
Mother, I'm coming home. I follow you into the park, through the jungle, through the dark. God, I never loved one like you. Boats and waterfalls, alleyways and payphone calls. I'll be here never with you. We laugh until we think we'll die, barefoot on a summer night. Nothing new is sweeter than with you. And in the street we run a free, like it's only you and me. Jesus, you got something to see. Oh, home, let me go home. Home is right around.
You see, all it takes is being open to the moment, just for a moment. And yes, sometimes doing a little dance. Dancing can help right now, especially during this time when things seem bleak and hard and dark. Be open to the moments of bringing joy. That's what this season is all about. Amen.
Our reading for this day is an excerpted version of last week's reading from the Gospel of Luke, from chapter 1. I want to share with you this week the famous song of Mary, included starting in verse 46, Mary's song of praise. My soul magnifies the Lord. And my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me and is holy in his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the holy. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance in his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. Here ends the reading.
O come in
Rejoice in Emmanuel.
Just a moment ago, we heard the famous passage from the first chapter of the Gospel of Luke, what Latin-speaking Christians for over 1,000 years referred to and called the Magnificat. The Magnificat is the first word in the ancient Latin of Mary's famous song, and it is a song, a very ancient song that has been sung and chanted in myriad ways down through the ages. My colleague, the Reverend Sarah Napoleon, shared her experience with the figure and the presence of Mary in a moving sermon last week. This week, I want to briefly take a different tack, a different approach to this famous passage from Luke on this All Music Sunday. After all, the words of the Gloria by Vivaldi that our choir is performing this morning are inspired in part by this ancient song. Lest we forget, Antonio Vivaldi was not just a composer, but he was actually a Catholic priest, deeply inspired by the teachings of the Latin Church. I always found the words of Mary's song, to be somewhat strange. It's not necessarily what you might expect a young woman to exclaim shortly after she finds out that she is pregnant, even pregnant with a special child. It is an exclamation of hope that the world will be somehow transformed and made better as a result of the divine intervening and shaking things up. And if there's any question about what kind of shakeup Mary is talking about, she is quite specific in the lyrics of her song. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the holy. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. Mary is hoping that she is part of some movement that will not just change people's hearts, but transform people's lives. She is exhilarated by the prospects that her child could bring about a transformation, not just of human hearts, but of human society, one in which those who are decent, one in which those who are fair-minded and generous will be rewarded, one in which peacemakers are celebrated and the meek are suddenly respected. Here we encounter the song and the hopes of a poor minority woman living amidst the brutal efficiency of the larger Roman Empire, living amidst the indifferent cruelty of her own leaders, in fact, in the form of King Herod. This is not a lullaby as much as it is a marching song, even a call to action. In some ways, this points to an important implication of the meaning of the word gospel. The word gospel comes from the Greek word evangelion and is often translated good news. It's a word from which we get the word evangelism. The birth and emergence of Jesus of Nazareth was good news for his followers and for the world at large. At least one can make that case. Sometimes, though, I'm not sure that translating the original Greek as good news does an adequate job in relaying the full force or the full feeling of this word for Jesus' listeners and followers and his family. What Mary was singing about was not just good news, but rather life-changing news. News that tells you your life is about to change for the better. News that suggests that your current situation is about to be transformed in ways that bring you delight and hope
and that feed your spirits. It's the good news you hear that you no longer have cancer after months of chemotherapy. It's the good news that you are not going to have to move out of your apartment or your house since the bank has decided not to foreclose upon your loan. It's the good news that your husband or your wife or your child will survive and be okay after they have been hospitalized with COVID-19. It's the good news that there is a viable vaccine that's almost available to treat this deadly virus and bring us back some semblance of our normal lives. This is the sort of good news that Mary is singing about in her ancient song. Mary was elated because she believed that her world and her life were about to change and change profoundly, profoundly for the better. Perhaps this year, we can relate especially to that sort of song. That's what this season is all about. Seeing areas of our lives and places in our world where there is potential for real change, for real healing, for real transformation. Here, during the darkest time of the year, we are invited to gaze out upon this world. And with all the optimism and the hope that we can muster, then ask ourselves where we can usher in good news in this struggling and difficult world. Asking these sort of questions seems especially poignant and important right now as we enter into the darkest and perhaps most challenging chapter of this global pandemic. This may be one of the hardest winters in modern American history. It's clear that thousands of Americans are going to die each day over the next 30 to 60 days. And it's clear that millions more are already facing financial ruin because of the slowdown and breakdown in our economy. I have to say, I am so proud and I am so inspired to see our congregation, our church, stepping up and reaching out during this unprecedented time. A group of us started the Weston Cares Fund in April, and this community-wide effort has taken off with a life of its own, with 100% of all the donations going to local agencies and local families in need. The stories and the reports we have heard and the requests that we have received have been truly sobering. Just this week, the fund gave away almost $23,000 to local agencies, to local families, truly in need, providing a little bit of good news during a seriously hard time. And perhaps what is most precious of all, we have heard from some of the recipients that the fund has been able to assist. These are people, in many cases, who are unemployed, who are sick, and who are at their wits' end. And they are not just touched by the modest financial support, but by the message that comes with it, that in this hostile and foreboding world, there really are people out there, people like us that care about them and their families and wish them well. Behold, we bring tidings of great, or at least good joy. During a time such as this, where there is such hardship and turmoil, we are reminded that the world can become kinder, the world can become more compassionate, when people like us take the time to care, take the time to show some concern and support for those suffering in our local communities. Part of what we are invited to do this time of year is to feel the darkness and to feel the pressures of the world as it is, and then explore ways that we can be a source of light and joy. Discover ways that we can push the world a little bit more in the direction of how it could be and away from how it is currently construed. I pray that all of us will be open to the many ways that we can bear tidings of comfort and joy to a world that truly, truly needs it. Amen. Wherever you are seated or standing right now, watching or listening to this, I invite you to take a deep breath in and extend your head a little bit further up into the air and exhale and join with me in this brief prayer about opening us up. O Lord of life and love, help us not to fall in love with the darkness that separates us from you and from each other, but to watch large-eyed and wide-hearted and open-handed and eager-minded for you, to dream and to hunger and to squint and to pray for the light of you and the life for each other. Lord, amidst the furrow-faced busyness of this strange season, we realize deep within us that your gifts of mercy and light, your gifts of peace and joy, and grace upon grace can only be received if we remain open. Open us then to see your glory in the coming again of the light of each day, in the light of children's eyes and lovers' smiles, in the light of the glaze of weariness that causes us to pause, in the light of truth wherever spoken and done. Open us to the songs of angels in the throng of traffic, in the rustle of shoppers, in the canopy of pre-dawn silence, in the hum of hope and the wailing of longing within us. Open us in the songs of the cries of our brothers and sisters for justice and for peace, and in our own soul's throb towards goodness. In addition, as is your tradition and inclination, I invite you to pray with me the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Many of you have inquired how you can support First Parish Church and our work here in Weston and the surrounding community, especially when we are not gathered here in person on Sundays. As we like to note quickly in these services, you can do so three basic ways. The first is by mailing a check into the church office. The second is by logging into your bank account and setting up a one-time or periodic donation to First Parish Church in Weston. That's my preferred method. Or you can use the third way, which is our PayPal account. And the easiest way to do that is to have a PayPal account yourself and then to search on our office email address, admin@firstparishweston.org. we should pop up as an authorized recipient. Regardless of the option you choose, we are grateful to you, the members and friends of this congregation, for continuing to support our church's voice and presence and mission. What we do here matters, and it is worthy of our support. And now, we are pleased to present sections from Antonio Vivaldi's beautiful, beautiful choral piece, number 589, Gloria.
Gloria, gloria, gloria.
For joining us for our program today. We invite you to check out our upcoming gatherings and programs, including our virtual fellowship hour that begins right around 11:30 this day on Zoom. There are links to all of our online meetings in the e-newsletter that was sent out on Friday, and also on the events calendar page of our website. This week, we are holding several virtual meetings and programs, including Knitters and Stitchers on Monday at noon, and Wednesday morning meditation at 8:30 a.m. My chat and check-in with the minister will be taking a holiday break for the next few weeks and will resume on Thursday, January 7th at 4 p.m. In addition, this coming Wednesday night at 7 p.m. on December 16th, we will be hosting a public community forum featuring Weston Police Chief Michael Golding. I also want to note that we are looking for readers and participants for a few upcoming services, including our service here in 2 weeks on December 27th. If you would like to help us read a poem by Maya Angelou by recording yourself at your home or from a distance, please check the online worship page of our website for more details or reach out to us at the office. Finally, I want to thank our choir, our soloists, Bill Sano and Jeff Weeding, and our video producers for putting together today's performance of Vivaldi's Gloria. This is an enormous amount of painstaking work that goes into creating a virtual choral performance like this. And I want to thank and acknowledge all of those of you who were involved. It's not easy. And the product was lovely, so thank you. We continue to discover many ways that we can participate as members of an active community from a distance. I am gratified to see many of you stepping up and reaching out during this difficult time. That's what churches like ours do. Thank you for joining us today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord keep all those whom you love, whether here or in some other place. May God be your companion and you be God's friend as you walk together through all the days of your life. And at the journey's end, may you find the welcome of God's love. It keeps us all. Amen.